Hi folks, and welcome to what is, for me, a rather odd video. How I came to be in possession of three different designs of smart wallet, compact wallet, call them what you will, is a rather long story, and I can assure you that I've bought these with my own money. So, yeah. I wish I'd done some due diligence before I started along this journey, and that's what I'm hoping to bring you in this video. I'm not really going to be pronouncing a winner here, just take you through some of the things that I wish that I'd thought about before I started parting with money. Yeah. And I hope you will excuse me the occasional sip of a glass of wine, because, yeah. Oh, that's nice. Now, I'm going to also go through a little bit of history. In fact, here are some of my notes, which I'm going to get out of the way. And we're going to go through a few odds and sods and things that you might want to think about. The key thing is to think about your loadout. What cards are you going to be carrying? Of what types? I've watched quite a number of videos on a number of wallets and different systems, and yeah, there's all sorts of bits and pieces out there, but the majority of people in the videos are only talking about credit cards, and they're typically talking about cash, and when they are talking about cash, they're usually talking about the good old American dollar, of which I have a few here. I'm in the UK, and we use good old British pounds. So we're going to see how those fare. We've got some other types of cards that are carried. Loyalty cards, travel cards, receipts, and the other things that we normally carry around. So how did I end up doing this? Well, this pretty much is my main purse. This is a German purse design. Bought it in Germany. When I go over, I typically end up at some sort of fair market, and there's usually a barrel, box, whatever, on public display with loads of different purse designs, coin purses, and I just root around until I find something I like. This is my main purse. It has the usual instant cards that I want. That's, you know, normally behind there. Picture cards, driving license and stuff, which I've obviously turned around and blanked out. And other things that I carry. You know, stamps, reference cards, my first aid card is in there, breakdown cover, all the information that I need to have. And novelties like this, which although a credit card, is actually a USB memory stick in credit card format. And I've usually got those with me. I also keep my cash in here, both notes and coins. It's pretty good, it's made of good leather, and as a result it's pretty thick. I normally try and keep this safe, call me paranoid. You can see roughly the thickness of this, and we'll come back to this on odd occasions, but it's typically kept deep within my backpack behind two different zips, which doesn't make it readily accessible for the day-to-day transactions if I go out to lunch and hit the shops. So that's where I ended up looking for a solution to that. Now, there's all sorts of things going on. One of the key things is RFID protection, and some of these wallets have actually got it, and some haven't, or allow you the choice to have it, or allow you different choices when you actually buy the wallet itself. But there's a number of things to think about, and, well, we're going to start with magnetic stripes. And people in their wallets usually keep a number of these, and they typically come in two forms, high-co and low-co. Now, a high-co card is typically black on a stripe, and a low-co card is typically looking a bit more, brownish. You should be able to see the difference in colour on these, I hope. Yep, that looks quite nice. The difference between high-co and low-co is this is a high coercivity card as opposed to a low coercivity card. What that means is that it takes a high amount of energy to coerce a change in the magnetic stripe on this card. So you'll typically find things like bank cards are made out of high-co. Low-co only needs a low amount of energy to coerce a change in the stripe on this card. Now, these cards usually have about 3 stripes on them, or at least the ones that I work on do. And that can be a bit of a problem. You see, in most purses, wallets, they'll be stored staggered, like that sort of thing. So the cards themselves will be staggered. But on these designs, they're kept tight to each other and quite close. So that's something that you might want to think about. Now, how much coercivity does it take for one stripe to affect the other? Well, it all depends on too many factors. We are talking quite a range of time, actually. It all depends on numerous things, like the amount of energy that was put into actually putting the information on this card in the first place. So if you have a gym card that you're using every week, whatever, you've got it with you, and after about a year it packs in, that's probably why. It's been close to another magnetic source for enough time for it to make a change. Now, in the UK, we have these, which are, these are the usual kinds of cards that you will find for transit, national transit, that is, and places like towns and small cities. Big cities usually have NFC cards like Oyster, yada yada, we'll come to that in a bit. But these have magnetic stripes on the back of them. And while cards like these are quite often used for just day returns, that sort of thing, and aren't really that much of a problem, these cards are also used for people who have, year-long cards, you know, that kind of, they will buy a season ticket, which may be a month, and in some cases for commuters, they'll buy a year card. And I did a bit of research, and somebody did actually ask the question, dear Transport for London, I'd like to make an FOI request regarding paper tickets, yada yada yada. Among the information that came back from TFL, believe it or not, was actually some interesting stuff. The first magnetic strip ticket was used in 1964. However, if you're referring to the current system, then that was in 1982, so these have been around for a while. Key, they say, it's low coercivity. So if you're intending, there'll be links in the hoo-ha bar, by the way, intending on keeping these sorts of tickets in a tight stack of cards, which are also magnetic themselves, you want to be a bit careful, and season tickets, be wary. So that is the thing about high-co, low-co, and just take a look at the cards that you're keeping. And if you are going to do something like this, then you may want to think about reorientating your low-co cards. These, fortunately, have the stripe in the middle. But it's worth thinking about your own tickets, what kind of stripe they've got on. These just have one stripe, by the way. And even on day tickets, I found myself having problems. So, yeah, think about your high-co and low-co cards if you're using them. Learn to identify what type of cards you've got, and treat accordingly is pretty much all I can say on that one. These days, we're tending to go to smart cards for a lot of things, but there's still an awful lot of cards, especially the low-co cards out there, because they're much cheaper to produce the equipment for in order to program them. You know, things are changing all the time, but hey-ho, I'll just keep those around and I'll use them as generic cards. Now, some of the other cards, what have we got here? We've got the one that came with the ridge, and we've got some generic test cards that came out of various pieces of equipment that I use, or that I test for, engineering cards, test cards, that sort of thing. So there is what's known as RFID, and RFID blocking. Now, there's typically two types of cards you'll find. RFID generally, and NFC, near field communication. Those will be the two cards that you'll typically hear of, and most people will be sort of familiar with the terminology of. Now, near field communication is a subset of RFID. It's typically a card with no power of its own, and it has an aerial inside it and a chip. When you put it up close to a reader, the reader is actually responsible for producing or transmitting enough power to the card to wake it up. It will put a signal back and hey ho. NFC is typically the kind of card used for most transit systems in major cities. You know, the kind of places that are large enough to actually warrant the investment by the transit departments in generating that kind of system. Now, RFID cards in general come in two major formats, active and passive. Passive encompasses sort of the NFC cards, but the other ones are that are on many people's minds. Well, credit cards usually have passive as well, passive RFID, and people usually think about using RFID protection for their credit card when it's in their wallet and they're walking around. But there are also active cards. I'm going to make a number of generalizations just to get you thinking in roughly the areas that you need to be thinking in to check things out. Because active cards actually have power in them as well, and they are transmitting a stronger signal so that they can travel quite a distance. If you're thinking about car entry cards, you're probably roughly in the right ballpark. And the trick is that a number of these will work on different frequencies. They're not all the same frequency, and some RFID blocking solutions don't block all the frequencies. I think this one's relying on that film there to block various bits and pieces. In the case of the ridge, you can see hopefully the change in metal here between the carbon and the outside and what I believe is the metal responsible for blocking the RFID inside. So if you have some of these passive cards, you will probably want to do a bit of research into the frequencies that are being used and the frequencies that any particular product you're buying is going to block. So if you do have an active RFID card and a passive RFID wallet, you probably want to test it to make sure that the wallet is actually protecting your card. In the case of cars, you might want to actually have a word with the car dealer and see what they've got to say. They may have a wallet which might help. I can see it potentially in the future being more of an insurance requirement once the insurance companies actually latch on to this and actually making it a condition that your car RFID card is kept in a safe place. Mm. Or in a manufacturer approved wallet. Keep an eye for the potential for something like that to come down the line. Now, RFID blocking itself takes a couple of different forms. As you've seen with these, that's passive blocking, typically something which will act as a shield to the signals being emitted, or stopping some of the signals getting in to activate the NFC cards. The others are active. And if you've got an active RFID blocking card, whatever, what they do is they've got their own power supply, and if they detect an RFID signal near them, they will put out their own RFID signal to drown it out. So there's active RFID blocking as well. But those typically have their own battery in them, and you'd need to do some research. I don't have any experience with RFID blocking, really. Because I'll tell you the truth, my own bank cards, I specifically request them to not have NFC on them. So if I need a new card, typically what happens is I'll call the bank up. I'll say, hey, my card has died. I need a new one. Can you send me one that doesn't have NFC on it? They'll inevitably send me one that has NFC on it, and I have to call them up and ask them to replay the last conversation and kindly send me another card without NFC on it, which they then do. That's happened more often than not, but hey-ho. So I don't really have any need for RFID blocking personally, because I make sure that my cards don't actually use them. But those are the kinds of things that you need to think about. If you've got RFID blocking, check it. Make sure it works. Some cases, you don't actually want RFID blocking or RFID blocking certain things. And there are other ways to this. Now, I got this, which has RFID blocking in it. But if I was in a transit system, if you're in London, you'll see quite a number of people actually go up to the thing with their wallets and just tap their wallets on the entry system, and it'll let them through. Obviously, if you've got your card in an RFID wallet, you're stuffed. One of the things that I did read about Slimfold is that you can buy a non-RFID version of this, but you can then buy RFID sleeves, so you can install the sleeves in whichever one, in whichever slot you want. Handy. So you could actually configure the wallet whichever way you like it. So you can have some areas protected, other areas not protected, because you might want to actually use your wallet to just tap and go. That sort of thing. Now, this one didn't come with RFID. But it does have, you can actually buy RFID cards to use in it. These aren't, obviously. This is just for, so you can buy, put one in there, put your cards in there, and actually have another one on top sandwiching it. So you've got protection like that. Personally, I didn't bother, because reading some of the reviews, the RFID protection cards are actually double the thickness of your average card. And when these can only practically handle about 8 cards, you're effectively wiping out the storage for about 4 cards, effectively. We'll come on to that in a bit. Well, in fact, let's go on to that now, shall we? A quick look at each of these 3. Now, this is the Ridge Wallet. I've gone through enough people's reviews to conclude that if you want to go for the Ridge Wallet, go for the Ridge Wallet. Don't go for any of the others. There are quite a few much cheaper knockoffs, but they come with various different problems. The Ridge itself comes in 2 particular flavours, and one of which is the money clip, the other one is the elastic band. Now, in retrospect, I think I should have gone for the elastic band, because when this is when I have this in a particular place, and you can probably see what I'm talking about, if that goes up against the screen of the mobile phone and it gets a bit of a jolt, too much of a jolt, I'm a bit scared. To be honest with you, that isn't too bad, you know? But I'm just, you know, I'm wary. The wrong angle, the wrong amount of force, and I could potentially say goodbye to my mobile phone. So if you're going to have something like this in the same pocket or bag as your mobile phone, money clips are something to be a bit wary of, and maybe consider an elastic solution. Now, many people have been talking about these, and although they say that they can take up to 12 cards, many people say that 8 is the practical maximum. They're pretty straightforward. I'm not going to go too much into the operation of this, as there are many videos around about this already. And you can start to get cards in there relatively easily. When it comes to some cards like these, however, which are thin cardboard, you're going to have a bit of a problem, It's a little bit more difficult to get some of them in there, especially putting them down, so you're just going to have to be prepared to have a little bit more to it. There are other cards that you will have in your possession, typically loyalty cards, which are more robust cardboard. Some of those go in quite neatly, so it can handle certain thicknesses, but you've got to think about the thickness of the cards that you're going to have in here. Getting it out, I mean, I've used this for more than a week now, and I found that when I had things in here, it was a bit difficult to actually have a grip to get them out because of various odds and sods, as I'll show you in a minute. Now, it did get a bit difficult. I've never actually been able to, let's see if I can do it now. Use the fan. How many cards have we got there? Four, possibly five. You're supposed to be able to push it up like that and sort of fan the cards out. I haven't had that much luck with that. There's five cards there. Let's see if there's six, seven. Let's just slip a couple more in there. Can I do it then? No, not quite so easy. Once you've got them out like this, I have found it a bit difficult to actually work out which card is which. I've ended up fanning them like that is the best thing that I can do. Find the card that I need, pull it out. I've typically ended up with two cards on a lot of things because I'm in a shop where I'll have a loyalty card and I'll have my credit card, which is usually on top. And then once I've finished with those, they'll go in again. A bit finicky. Now, again, this is going to come down to your needs, your wants, and all the rest of it. I typically ended up using things like this, ejecting with the left hand, which means when I've got stuff then to put in here, it's upside down. Now, I believe that I can possibly rotate this and have it the other way in, but I'm a bit concerned. I'll try it at some point. But because I'm paying by card, I never end up with any cash back, you know? But what I do end up with are receipts for the transactions. And that is what I'll end up putting in here. So I'll go to the first shop, just scroll it up as best as I can because it's not going to fit. Next shop, another receipt. You can see it starts getting a bit difficult because the paper itself, receipt paper, isn't the best. And if you're in a shop and something and you're in a queue, sometimes the operation of this can get a bit messy. It all depends on the paper you've got. I typically find it easier to just get everything out, put it all in a pile, add the new receipt to it, and then push that back in. But as you can see, it just turns it into a bit of a mess. The reason being is because I don't have my notes in here. My notes are in my purse, which is buried, and this is most shop transactions are done with credit cards, so I'm not actually dealing with cash. So, that's one of the issues with this. Now, we will go through something here, because I see a number of the videos that people are talking about. And just to get something clear, that's a note which is straightforward. Bifold is that, so it's folded in two. And as you can see, even for the dollar bill, it's not the most ideal. Trifold, I mean, if you look up a trifold wallet, you'll see that it sort of folds the note like that. So that's trifold. And quadfold is when you typically fold it like that and like that, and then you put stuff in. So a lot of people using this will use their dollars quadfold. Trifold, I haven't actually tried trifold here, but as you can see, getting a decent trifold straight off the cuff is not easy, but that works as well. That's quite nice. It keeps it a little bit thinner than quadfold. You know, you're gaining a little bit there. Trifold works quite nicely. The problem is just doing a trifold on the fly. It takes a bit of practice. But because the dollar note is a bit thicker, quite a bit thicker than your receipts, that goes in there quite nicely. And you know, they just slip in there quite reasonably. So, also, there's quite a cultural difference between the UK and the US. The people that I've talked with from the US, a number of them don't actually use cash at all. The cash, typically, I actually had a discussion with the... when I went to go and get these dollar bills, I actually had a chat with the cashier about dollar bills. Actually, there's a $5 bill, but he said that they were as rare as hen's teeth. And I believe that he said something about a $2 bill as well, but I've forgotten what he said about the two. The most commons are 1s, 10s and 20s. And people seem to use them for tips. They've typically got $1 bills around for tipping when they go to a restaurant, etc., which is something that we don't do in the UK. So even though people are still paying by card for the majority of their transactions, and you can see that's taken 15 bills quite neatly there. And that's trifold. If I was to attempt that quadfold, I don't think I'd get 15 in there at all. But even though people are paying with... Nah, won't even go. So if you get the hang of trifold, you can get up to 15 bills in there, which is quite neat. Not bad at all. So even though people are paying for things with their credit cards, they're giving their tips in dollar bills. In the UK, we don't tip like that, really. Our system, we rely on the restaurant or wherever paying the staff the living wage, and everything, all our taxes and everything, are all in the purchase price that we see on the ticket. So we don't usually have to tip, only if at some restaurant that we do. There is a service charge that some restaurants can put in, and you'll see service charge so much percent, and that's basically the restaurant building in a tip to the thing. So that's the only time you'll see it in the UK very much, or commonly, to put it another way. And then it's part of the bill that you get at the end of the day. So sometimes if you don't pay a service charge, you can end up leaving a tip. So that's one of the things in the UK. UK notes, that's the wrong one. They're in here. I have one of each of the main three notes in the UK at the moment, which is the 5, 10 and 20. You'll notice that our notes are different sizes. These are actually the new polymer notes. This 20 is actually an old paper note, and the new 20 comes in polymer form this year, 2020, in fact, and it will shave about a centimeter off each of the dimensions. So the new 20 polymer will be a bit smaller than this. Now, in the US, back in about 1928, they made some decisions, and the bills were released in 1929, I believe. And the $1 bill, the $10 bill, the 20, everything is the same size. And one of the things that I got a bit of a shock of, you know, if you see a film, you'll typically see criminals like sniffing the notes. And they do have a bit of an odd smell to them, believe it or not. I think the smell is starting to wane from this. It's still there. But yeah, if you ever get some new US dollars, give them a sniff. Yeah, be that criminal in the movies, you know. But it's very interesting. So so the US has the US dollar has been around for more than 90 years in its current form, and it shows no sign of changing, as opposed to the British notes. Now we'll come back to these in a minute, but I actually have some of these. Now these are just demonstration notes. These aren't actually white notes, as they were called. And things have changed radically as far as British notes are concerned over the years. the white notes, and these actually came with some history notes on them. Let's have a look. The 20 was issued in 1725. So it's got quite a long history, because it was withdrawn from circulation in 1943. So while Americans had been paying with these for about 20 odd years, we were still using these. Can you credit it? It's bleeding huge. Imagine getting these in one of these. How many times would you have to fold it? One, two, three, meh, whatever. Nuts. Absolutely nuts. As you can see, these are not for legal, not legal tender. They're just examples. So for more than 200 years, the white 20 note was in existence. Now, I do actually have and somebody else in the village who actually is a bit of a note nut, and he does actually have a white fiver. The white fiver came in 1793, and we were still using it up until 1957. So it was 1957 that we were still using the white fiver in Britain. And it's just bonkers. Now, there are many other types of notes, of course. There are giants, or titans, as they're sometimes known, which are promissory notes between banks. I believe that in order for Northern Ireland and Scotland to issue their own notes, they have to issue giants or titans to the Bank of England in order to generate their own notes. And yeah, it's interesting to read up on us and how it all works. But yeah, so while the US was happily using some quite advanced notes for their times, in terms of colour, these I believe the security has changed over the years. But, you know, I can't understand how, you know, from what I was reading, when they did this and kept everything the same size for security, and I can't work out what the reasons were. But hey ho. So British notes for quite some time were like this, pretty much. And the first multicoloured, although predominantly dark blue, series B notes started coming in 1957. Now that was, oof, what, 60 odd years ago? And they keep changing. If you have a look at many things, the British notes have changed quite markedly over the years. And these are our current ones. And actually, interestingly enough, there are some features on them. The 5 has no raised nodules on it, but the 10 has. If you feel a £10 note, you'll feel some braille. Where is it? I think it's about there. And you can feel some braille markings. So someone who's blind, oh, there it is, I think, can actually feel the note and work out the denomination by the braille braille markings. Where the heck is it? My fingers aren't that sensitive tonight. I was feeling it before while I was working this out. Oh, there they are. They're actually up there with the signature. I don't know if you can actually see those. See the indentations? Can you see them? But they're there for blind people to tell which note is what. And the 20, when that comes, that will also have a braille marking on it. So this year, this note will get a bit smaller. Now, something else with the folding of these notes in the US is that blind people typically have various ways of telling which note is which, because they're all the same size and there's no braille markings on them whatsoever. In fact, Canada was well ahead of many others, and a few other countries as well have been well ahead on things like the braille indentations for quite some time. We're just catching up now. And that is one of the other questions. What is the US going to do with its notes in the future? Given the age of these notes, is it going to redesign them? Is it going to build in braille things? Because one of the common tricks that I keep reading about with blind people is when they've got dollar notes in their wallets and purses, they keep them straight. When they're $10 bills, they keep them folded. and they'll quad fold them for 20s. So when they go in their purses and wallets, they know which note is which by how it's folded. So it makes things quicker for them. How they check their change, I've got no clue. Now, talking of change, we start with a 5. And we did actually have a £1 note for quite some time. The note was actually changed with a coin. And funny enough, I don't actually have a £1 coin with me. Damn. But yeah, we've gone with a pound coin. We've also got a £2 coin. So it's why? I'm not 100% sure. Certainly pound coins and £2 coins make it easy for vending machines, as opposed to vending machines, you know, you see people with vending machines feeding dollar bills. But hey ho. And this, even our pound coins have changed because of security issues. They're now bimetal, like many euro coins are. And it's it does make things difficult. So let's see, if we had this lot, what would it do? It would go in, but it would obviously be over. What if we try to trifold it? As you can see, the different sizes of notes does make things a bit awkward. There we go. Will that go in? Yeah, that'll go in. And it's roughly the same, but you've got to trifold them on the fly. And obviously, if you quadfold them, that'll get more interesting still. So, yeah, my use in the Ridge wallets, for me, this is a bit of a concern when I'm storing it in the same area of my bag as the mobile phone. I'm a little concerned that it's only going to take the wrong amount of force, bang, and that's going to be it. So I'm a bit concerned about that, and if I was doing this again, I'd have got it with the strap rather than the money clip. Interestingly enough, this is the iClip, and it's another interesting one. Again, built to take 12 cards. Many people are saying it can only successfully take about 8. So let's get some of these out of here. I did find this awkward. This has got another mechanism in it, which you just hold that down and put your cards in. how many is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And as you can see, the seven cards already coming up to close to the lip here. So if I put an 8th in, you know, it's starting to get to the point where they can potentially just break out loose. Which is a thing when you consider this clip here. It's not as strong as this one. And what you're supposed to be able to do is just put your money in. They actually give you a piece of card which demonstrates it. And you just put your money in like that. And then that actually helps you to make the trifold, which brings it down. Pretty neat. Works with money. Not so much if you're keeping your receipts. You just got to sometimes be a bit better, be a bit cleverer about this. About when you're putting your receipts in, because that's what I'm using them for. I keep the receipts in here. As you can see, this one's been folded already. And sometimes it's just a case of stuff it, folded it. If it's getting a bit long, it's just a case of stuff it, fold it in half, stick it in there. And just, yeah. It's not the most elegant solution for receipts. So if you're like me, you may find your mileage varies. One of the odd things is, I'm just going to do this a favour and replace this with the cash. Which is a bit thicker, you might think, how do you handle some of this stuff? Well, you might actually want to put, it goes through, you work your way through until you find the card you want, then you slip that out through the bottom, and hey presto. And because I'm just typically getting a store card and my credit card, it's not too bad. Then when you're done, you slip it in. And as long as you keep your the credit card on the top, it's not too much of a hassle to find the next store card and your credit card. And there you go. And they go back in. The problem has been putting stuff in here. Now, this is going to depend a lot on where you shop and how you shop. I mean, if you're in a relaxed place where it's not going to take much, you're not under any pressure. The few moments that it takes to actually deal with this, get out what you want, or to put a note back, yada yada, it takes a little bit of getting used to. Once you've done it a few times, you get the hang of it relatively easily. But it takes precious seconds. And what I found is when I'm in a supermarket queue, and there's people queuing behind me, those precious seconds are a real pain. I'll typically have to just grab everything, then move to one side and deal with this while the next person is being served. So it depends on what environments you're going to use these in. If they're a little bit fiddly, then you probably want to be a bit careful. The obvious question that I had is what happens when you get down to the last card? What happens? Well, that's what happens pretty much, but it's not the end of the world. You'll notice that the note didn't come out, and I can put another card in there relatively easily and start doing things again. And this is not that expensive to handle things with. So, yeah, you might want to think about it, but if you do a lot of if you need to handle things in a hurry, the time it takes to handle this and put your stuff back in here can be a bit odd, especially if you've got your change as well. And like I said before, I'm typically using paying with a card, and what's going in here are the receipts. So that's that one. Let's take a look at this one. Now this is interesting. Thai, whatever the, what are they using this for? There's I've forgotten the name of the material, but this is da 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 da. Okay, you're gonna have to look this up yourself by the looks of it. I've forgotten the name of the material. I didn't write it down. It's not in there either. Is it here? Slim fold wallet. Thin, light, strong, features, holds about 10 cards. Tyvek, that's it, Tyvek. Now, Tyvek is the material they use for FedEx envelopes, and Slimfold are not the only people who are making these kind of wallets using Tyvek. In fact, Slimfold do a number of different wallet types with different loadouts. So let's take a bit of a look at this one. It's very thin. It is startlingly thin. And it's put together in an interesting way. You've typically got two cards here, two cards here, three cards here, and three cards here. Now, what you may not be able to see is there's plastic in here. So I'll put the first one behind the back. The second one actually goes there. Now, hopefully you can see the plastic, which is there, and this one would then go there. And this then goes on top of that and slides in there. And you've got the same thing here. You've got one here. That's already slipped in. You've got another one here. If I can actually get this in. Oh, there's actually two cards in there. That's why it's having problems. Let's just separate those. And interestingly enough, was that actually supposed to go in front of that? I'll come to that in a second. So the second, next card goes there. Next card goes there. Then you have a card here. A card here. And then you can slip two cards in here. That seems to be the way it's done. Then your money basically goes in here. Keeps everything very slim, and it's I must have knackered something up there, because it's not, there you go, that's better. And that's what it can go down to. If you're putting that in your pocket will keep that slim. And you can see the width of the that as opposed to that. You can see what it's doing. It's about yeah. As they're compressed, you can see that's about 50% of the width of this, but this has got coins in it. So yeah, and that's got about 50 notes in it, and this hasn't got any. So so there you go. That's roughly how it works. The trick I found is accessing the cards. You know, because if you want, you've got to think about your layout of your cards, whatever wallet you're buying. I mean, we've got 6 cards back here. How the heck am I supposed to get to them? You know, getting at the back card isn't too bad. You know, I can get at that one. Getting at the top card is easy enough, but getting at the middle card, you know, you're relying on that that little lip in order to be able to grab that card. And so it takes a bit of practice, and it does. This looks delicate, but it isn't. This Tyvek material is really something else. And you know, thinking about this and looking at it, if I just get these out, one thing I'm going to have to test when I actually get another Oyster card, I've got no intention of, is this material here, the silver material here. If this silver material is actually the RFID protection, then if I slip this behind it, then I could probably use an NFC transit card, and that would be usable. But if it isn't, then how do I get this card in between this and that? Unless I've got it completely wrong, you're not supposed to put a card in there. But if that's the case, then you can only really get a couple of cards in here. Or are you supposed to get 3 cards in there? That's a possibility. But there, you actually got another, and yet another possibility, in that it's possible to actually put a transit card the other side of this material and be able to do the touch thing with a wallet. Maybe that's how you do it. You know, touch on. So you could probably get more cards in there. But just for the sake of argument, let's just load this up again. That's 1, 2, 3. If you haven't got any cash and you're just using this to keep your cards safe, then as you can see, this stitching here is what allows the wallet itself to have a flexible width in the hinge. Because you see, that is responsible for actually taking that out. So yeah, the whole history of notes are pretty interesting, to be honest with you. You know, this feels like I'm just going to rip the shreds out of it, but actually the Tyvek seems to be holding up. I'd probably have to go some to actually rip one of the corners here. And the cost of this, you know, it took about 2 weeks in regular post to come. It's going to be interesting, because the long story short is I can see myself using this one more than these. Reason being is because I can have a specific card in a specific area and I can get to it. And when it comes to whatever I like, I can just take whatever receipt I have and just slam it in there. And it's just quick to go. So no more, your receipt please. You know, I can have a number of receipts already. Get the receipt, slam it in there. That's it, I'm gone. If you know what I mean, it's quicker to operate than these versions, which is quite a bit of a bonus for me. So yeah, this is the one I'm probably going to use, and this is the one that it's going to be interesting to see just how well this Tyvek material holds up to the bashing that I give it in everyday use. It's going to be very interesting. They do a number of different types of wallets in a number of different types of styles, depending on how many cards you're carrying, whether or not you're handling cash, that sort of thing. Yeah. And there's a lot of interesting history behind cash as well. And it was in 1916. It was in the 7th century that China started with banknotes. But I think it was it Kublai Khan? I think somebody actually, you know, traders at the time were carrying coins of various precious metals, and that the notes were much easier to carry. But obviously people weren't that that enthused about carrying notes or accepting notes in trade which had no intrinsic value. And I think it was Kublai Khan, I'll have to check, but that basically said, if you don't accept my money, I kill you. So any trader which didn't accept the promissory notes would basically be signing their own death warrant. But after Kublai Khan's era was over, it lasted. Promissory notes sort of waned again, and then they took off quite some hundred years later, with the Bank of England, I think, being established in 1694. And yeah, then we got the white notes and the rest of it. Now, I talk about some of these notes. There is a £50 note, as I think there is also a $50 and a $100 other notes. But certainly, I don't know about the US, but certainly in the UK, I see a £50 note very, very rarely. And if I have one, I'd be very careful about it, because people are wary about the £50 note, because it's typically said to be used more often by criminals and money launderers rather than everyday people in everyday circulation. So, yeah, a £50 note is treated with some caution by shopkeepers, whoever you try to deal with it with. There's been discussion about wiping the £50 note out of the circulation notes, full stop, but that's something which keeps getting mooted, and whether they're actually, what they're going to do with the £50 note, who knows. They may make a polymer version. They may decide to just keep it as it is, because it's so there's no other choice of what to do. Or they may decide, okay, the £50 note has had its day, let's just take it out of circulation. So the £50 note was very, very interesting. And I think it was very interesting about the one, and I think there was also a £2 note as well, because there was a run on the bank in 1797, and they needed, you know, the gold standard and all that lot, and they ended up issuing £1 notes, and I think £2 notes as well. The whole issue of what notes were designed and when they went out and all the values and how they've changed is just incredible. But you know, when I look at something like the dollar, which has been around in its current form for more than 90 years, and then look back at the history of the pound and how our notes changed so rapidly in comparison to the dollar, it's just wah. Yeah, just for interest, this iClip, because it's not as strong as the other one, it can take some of these cards, and it doesn't really matter, you can put whatever you like in there, it'll handle it reasonably well, but sometimes it gets stuck if the card is not of a standard size. So it doesn't like that loyalty card at all. But you may want to keep, you know, some of the things come with a card, and you might want to use that as a sacrificial backing card. It doesn't like that very much, does it? Yeah. In order to keep stuff running and working. But yeah, different types of cards, how you want to use them, what you keep with you, how you use it, who knows? But certainly, You know, the average working person just needs some basic cards and whatever they need for transit. It's the householder that then deals with the receipts and all the rest of that jazz. It's amazing how often now, for many transactions, it's not worth keeping a receipt for. I mean, if it's food, the food is typically of the quality that it's going to cost you. You know, if you've got a tin of beans that's like out of date or whatever, it's going to cost you more to go back to the shop and kick up a fuss than just toss them in the bin and open another can. You know, so keeping the receipt in many transactions is a bit of a joke, because the receipt allows you to go back. If you're buying clothes or something, or electronics or something, then you'll want to keep the receipt. But it depends on what you're shopping for and what you're doing in your daily life, I suppose. So, for me, I do keep things hanging around. I do keep emergency cards for my breakdown, identity cards for bits and pieces that I have to. But this is buried deep within my backpack and safe from safer from theft, shall I say. And this one has some sacrificial cash and bits and pieces in it, or whatever it is now. I'll probably will just have some sacrificial cards, my main credit card, loyalty cards, bit of cash. And if somebody mugs me, they can have that, and they think, yay, and hopefully leave me in peace. And yeah, so we'll have to work out how things go, how these things go together. And I should really have sat down and thought what I've got and how I want to organize things before I then actually went to buy something that that then fitted the bill, as opposed to going by, there was an offer on this, there was 10% off, so I thought, okay, what the hell, I'll go for it. And yeah. So yeah, these won't be wasted, I've got other uses for them. But yeah, it may actually be that I take the cards out of here and put them in one of these that's then become secondary. I mean, one of the things you can do is that you get a screwdriver with here, so you can actually take the plate off, and I could potentially undo the clip and just use this to keep ID cards and emergency cards. And then potentially, what I'd do with the change though, what would I do with the money? You know, this is what I should have done before I embarked on this idiocy. Sat down and thought about things before I actually went and started spending money on this stuff. And that, I think, ladies and gentlemen, is the lesson of this entire long, rambling, idiotic video. Sit down and think what you want to do before you start spending your hard-earned on a wallet that in some cases will leave you with no actual money left over in order to put in it, because they're so expensive. And there we go. I hope you've enjoyed this complete waste of a ramble of a video. And in some ways I do envy the Americans with the solid long design of their money. Ours just seems to be changing every 5 bleeding minutes. But hey ho. Incidentally, I think that the change in the money all the time possibly contributes to the higher prices that we pay in some of the vending machines, because whenever they change a note or a coin, they have to redo the mechanism, which must cost them a small fortune. So anyway, there you go. Hope you've enjoyed this, and I'll see you on the next video. Take care of yourselves. Ciao for now.